Agenda for our course is email basics. We look at a few basic things about email. What are they? How? What is the advantage? And all those things. We'll also look at role of emails in investigations. Third, we look at email forensic tools. Some of the tools that are used in the cyber security world. All right. We look at cyber crimes, and we look at email investigations. Okay. And then we'll try and see how email hunting and detection can be done. All right, there's a small sheet on what steps you need to follow. All right, on what exactly you need to do. So also you can think through your response. It's like a letter, right? You can type and reply and then make changes without actually before sending. You can see what is what needs to be sent. Right, so the sender and receiver don't have to be working at the same time, right? They can be asynchronous. I can send an email at 9 a.m. India time. Somebody can receive it in a few seconds or minutes, and say if it's 2 p.m. India time, and he replies back, right? He may be anywhere in the world, right? So this avoids problems like telephone lag or trying to contact someone who is in a different time zone, right? So I don't worry. Email also makes it very easy to keep a record of your communication, right? It's like an artifact, right? A proof which you can save and then refer to in later copies of email you send as well as you receive, and you can show it as a proof, all right? And also you can reach a lot of people at once, all at once, all right? It is possible to send one message to 100 of recipients at the same time, or you can send a private message to one individual, right? So this is how an email flow happens. So Bob is using user message agent or MMAU, okay, mail user agent. He connects his machine using SMTP to the server, which is using a mail transfer agent or MTA. All right. So whenever you are sending and receiving, SMTP is involved. All right. So that MTA further sends it to some other server, a bigger server maybe. Okay. And that big server also forwards it to the receiving server where you're sending that email to that domain. All right, over there you've got mail delivery agent sitting there, or MDA, and the other guy who is the recipient, right? Say for example Alice, who is here in our case, so she uses mail user agent MAU again to pull her emails, which can be through POP3 or IMAP. All right. Now, I told you the advantage of using emails, right? Fast and all these things, right? But there's another problem. Whenever you have advantages, you have some disadvantages as well, all right? Now, the disadvantage with emails is, first of all, junk mails, right? They're annoying, right? And they look exactly like traditional emails, right? So you cannot differentiate between any normal mail or a junk mail or a spam email. You get ads, right? Free services come with ads, right? So you watch TV, you get ads. So in emails also, whenever using free emails, free services, you get some ads. Or also you have to pay the price of having to click around them to read your emails. Okay, a misinterpretation is again a disadvantage when using emails. So emails, they don't have any tone, hand gestures, right? Or any emotion attached to them, which can lead to a misunderstanding, right? Somebody, for example, types in bold, right? Or uses exclamation marks. So that comes out as somebody shouting, right? Although he may be excited, right? Happy. So a misunderstanding can be there. Now, email messages can be passed on to others, right? You should always count on the possibility of message ending up in the email box of somebody else, right? Who was not intended for. So I send my email to somebody, he forwards it to somebody else saying, see, he sent me this email. So, and I have no control on others, sending my email outside. You can hide behind email. That is and it's tempting to use email because instead of facing the person, right, face to face, right, when you have to deal with some unpleasant situation, right? So it's better, it's best to talk. Right, but people always, at times, they start using emails to hide themselves. Right, now in emails, the from that you see is your email address, right, which is the address that you're sending the email from. Usually this is already filled in with your address. The two is where you are trying to send that email, which is a primary recipient or recipients. Subject is a concise indication of the subject of your message, right? What is the topic? And it's also important to include a subject because it will benefit the recipient by allowing them to see what this email is about even before they open it. Okay, and it's helpful when you're sending email to somebody who might not recognize their address. So it will be it'll indicate them this is not a spam. It is, it is sent from somebody he knows, or maybe it's important for him. Then within email you got CC and BCC. All right, this space adds secondary addresses to your email. It's like carbon copy, right? Okay, you can add more and more people. You can address somebody and then add more and more people, to have them look what is going on. All right, it's like an additional this thing. And this allows you to copy a person on the email that you are sending that response to. The BCC is the blind carbon copy. Okay, if you send in a copy of email to somebody by putting their address in BCC, right, they can read the 2 and see, but they'll not be able to see the person's address. Okay, so coming back to the email basics, so MAU, right, they're using the email client, right? It's a desktop based application, enables users to read, write, compose, even send emails from their configured email addresses, right? Commonly used clients can be like client server model. It's a standalone model, right? So I use Microsoft Outlook or Mozilla Thunderbird, or I can use web-based Gmail, Yahoo Mail, AOL, over 443 or port 80. Okay, 443 is a secure way of communication. 80 port 80 uses HTTP, which is clear text communication. All right, then you got MTA. All right, message transfer agent. So this is known as a mail server, which accepts emails from the sender and routes them to their destinations. All right, so MTA receives and then forwards them. Examples can be SendMail, XM, PostFix. All right, so these are some examples of message transfer agent. Then you got message delivery agent, or MDA. All right, so the application responsible for receiving an email from the MTA, right? So this receives emails or applications from other email servers, stores them in a mailbox of the recipient. All right, and then for example DevCot, right? So this is an example where you have your emails or Exchange server, you have your mailbox stored there till the time you don't want to access them, or you are waiting to reach office, then you can come and access them. All right, then SMTP is a simple mail transfer protocol. Okay, so the outgoing mail server, which allows users to send emails to a valid email address, which is sending protocol. All right, so when a user sends an email, the sender's host SMTP interacts with the receiver's SMTP. All right, so SMTP servers typically listen on port 25. All right, then you got POP3. Okay, POP3 server is again a protocol, post office protocol version 3. Right, so it's an internet protocol that retrieves email from email servers, and this handles the incoming emails, listens on port 110, okay, and automatically downloads them to the user's hard disk and removes them from the server. So SMTP POP3, right, SMTP receives, POP3 pulls out all the emails, remove them, right? If you use POP3, your emails will be removed from the email server and stored on your hard disk. If your hard disk crashes, then the whole thing is gone. All right, then you got IMAP, or Internet Message Access Protocol. So it's a internet protocol designed for accessing emails on an email server. So IMAP listens on 143, port number 143, or if it is IMAP S or secure, it is port 993. And this keeps email on the server even after the users have already downloaded them, removed them, read them. Okay, so your emails are there on the web server. Now this email enables the user to use multiple devices, and then it helps them to check their emails even if they are roaming around, they're going around somewhere, right? Then you can use and check all your emails. Okay, now email, again, as I told you, comprises of three parts, right? So I've marked all those parts. Okay, the first part is called as the email header, right? So this contains information about the email origin, the sender's receiver's email address. It might have date time of the message when it was sent. Okay, it might have a subject line, priority, MIME version, and we'll see what this is later on. Okay, so this is the first part, the email header. Then you got the email body, right? This contains the actual message. That message can be HTML or plain text. All right, so this can also include images, hyperlinks, all right, pointing to other websites across on the internet, or it can also contain attachments, right? So email body, you'll have an attachment shown somewhere, and then finally you got the email signature, right? So this provides information about the recipient, on the identity, like who is sender, who is sending you that email. So these three are the basic parts of a email. Now, what is the role of email in investigations, right? So emails actually play a very important role in business communication, right? When you have to talk to somebody, you have to send them some information, receive some information, and it's one of the most important reason why internet has flourished, right? And there are a lot of applications, they're very convenient, they have the mode of sending, receiving as well, even documents, right? Not only from computers but also from other electronic gadgets like mobile phones, tablets, right? You now have Android and so many mobile smartphones where you can create your own message, right? Save it as a document and then send it as an attachment, right? But how does email come in, right? The negative side, right? So for that email, now criminals can leak important information about their company, right? When I say criminals, these guys can be internal threats sitting inside your own office, inside with along with you, right? They might be your, they're part of your staff, part of a department, and these guys are criminal. They are leaking information about the company to outside world, right? Now, since most of these days, the tasks that we perform are performed by through computers, and in relation to the this thing, email obviously plays a lot of important role, as I told you. So, email investigation again is a very key task at resolving all forensics, digital cases, or that relate to computer crimes. And there can be a variety of reasons that prove that investigation email is not the only task. Now, the first reason behind is the ease, informality of emails that provides user a relaxation in many habits that is there and likely to be expected while writing a general email on a hard disk or even on a copy of paper, right? Now, most of these users are actually not aware of the fact that email investigations can lead them to serious conclusions. Instead of, they consider email communication some most private source of communication. So the final factor that shows accessibility of emails on various servers, right? And you've got logs, what people have sent, what they've received. Even if they deleted an email, a log would be made, right? So that is the role of emails has only increased over the recent years. All right, so when we come to email forensics, right, so this is actually the study of source of content of email as evidence, right? And the idea or the reason is to identify the actual sender and recipients of a message along with whatever information that can be gathered from the, like, time and date, transmission, intention of the sender, right? So in digital forensics, emails are actually considered a crucial source of this email header and email header analysis. And this is why it has become very important to collect information during forensic processes. All right. Now we look at some forensic tools. Okay. So now forensic analysis, again, as I told you, study of the source and content of email messages for evidence, identifying the actual sender, recipient, date and time it was sent, etc. Right? Where you collect credible information or credible evidence, and this is done to bring criminals to justice. All right. So erasing or deleting an email doesn't necessarily mean that it's gone forever. All right. Often emails can be forensically extracted, even though they might be deleted. The criminal may think that he's deleted, he's safe, right? So forensic tracing of emails, again, is a similar to traditional detective work, right? Retrieving information from mailbox files. So some of the top, we look at some of the top forensic tools in the next few slides. The first one is MyTech email viewer, right? So this is basically a viewer for Outlook Express, Windows Mail, Windows Live Mail, Mozilla, Thunderbird messages, databases, and a single EML file primarily. So this displays a list of contained messages that are needed with all the properties that are there, like an ordinary email client. And the messages can be viewed in detailed view, including attachments, HTML preview. And this app is basically used for standalone files, right? Which may have Microsoft Outlook or Outlook Express messages database files, which is usually IDX, MBX, DBX, or Windows Vista Mail, right? And the application is based on MyTech technology, right? And it displays all these properties of various emails, and it has a powerful searching and filtering capability. Okay. Because this is again important. You might have thousands of emails, but if you are unable to search or filter, then again it's no use, right? So this tool actually does a lot of very good fast searching and filtering, and will allow you to extract exact email addresses of all those emails in open folder one using just one click. All right, you can have selected emails can be saved in EML files with or without their attachments. And those can further be extracted. The attachments can be extracted from selected emails by just one command. All right. And then you can, when you're creating a forensic case, for example, and then you can use this very easily to print out and, take out all information. So I've added a few slides. So this is what it looks like. All right. And when you see this, you'll have all the details, right? Very easily you can find out the time, properties of email, details, whatever you need, right? So it's a fantastic email viewer for investigations, forensic investigations. Okay, the next one, the tool that I would recommend is OST PST viewer. All right, so it's from Nucleus Technologies. It helps you view OST and PST file easily without connecting to any Exchange server or anything, right? So, and you can scan OST files, PST files. So OST is offline files made from MS Exchange servers when you're using MS Outlook, and PST is the database where Microsoft Outlook stores their files or emails. And this viewer actually displays that data, which is saved, including email messages, their contacts, calendars, notes, in a very beautiful structure. Okay. So if you look at this, this is not MS Outlook, all right? It is the viewer part, OST file. So it's an offline file that has been recovered, and it easily shows you all the data, all the structure, all the files in a similar format, okay? Or something like this, the PST file, right? When you click on contacts, you get the list of contacts whom he was contacting, right? Email addresses, attempts when they logged on, right? Anything, all details. All right. So if you're looking for the quickest and simplest way and tool to find and extract information, right? OST PST viewer is your best solution for you. All right. And these are used in Microsoft Exchange Server primarily. Okay. Because the Exchange Server stores data on the local computer, right? So you can't directly connect to that Outlook file, but with this OST PST viewer, you can actually open all these files in just a few clicks. And this is, it's actually designed with very familiar Microsoft Outlook look-like interface. So anyone using Microsoft Outlook will easily be able to browse and find out. And you can manage also, interact with the PST files, the contents, right? And then search whatever you want, the relevant information. So with this, they also have a pro edition, a professional edition, where you can manage the content beyond just viewing it, right? You can export them using various file formats. You can export one or all the attachments, okay? Or you can change and update the follow-up flags, right? Read, unread status, advanced, search, and all those things are there, all right? Then you got Email Tracker Pro, all right? Pro means professional. So these are two versions, but I would prefer using Pro, right? So now over 95% of emails are spam, right? Now spam can be harmless, but it is very annoying. It may contain virus, or it can try to trick somebody into giving up some personal information, which can lead to identity fraud, right? So this Pro, this email tracker Pro, offers the ability to trace an email using email header, but also comes up with a spam filter as an advanced edition, all right, and which scans and each email as it arrives and warns the user if it is suspected or something, right? So eventually, when you stopping spam from reaching the intended victim, you are actually blocking an attack, right? So multiple emails can be traced at the same time, and it also keeps a track of them, right? So the geolocation of an IP address is the key location for determining the threat level or validity of an email message. So for example, from where it came from, it will give you a fantastic view, right? It will tell you how that email traversed, right? Like the world map, it'll analyze you, it can give a new trace, you can have reports also, generate reports and then send out to your boss. You can also delete reports if you want, or you can generate and stop report and then do a menu, this thing where you can view all headers, right? So it's a very GUI kind of a application, right? For example, who is information, right? Which actually tells you the DNS details. So the contact details of that organization, where it is registered, who is responsible for IP addresses, the website, you know, all those tracing. So that can be done easily using this application. Then you got Email Tracer. Okay, it's a simple name. It's an Indian tool, a free tool, right? It's an Indian effort on cyber forensics and a pretty good one. All right, it's primarily used by law enforcement agencies, cyber law, cyber crime agent teams, and police use it. So there's an organization called Resource Center for Cyber Forensics. Okay, so they have developed a lot of tools, cyber forensic tools. So all you need to do is create your own free login. It's an online tracer, right? So you put up all your header details there, and then it'll trace and find out and tell you all information. All right. So it'll tell you where that email came from the IP address of the actual machine, the computer's machine, right? Not the email server. Okay. If there are any, anything associated with that IP address or that domain, it'll tell you all the details as well. Okay. And then tell you how that email traversed, right? What path was taken. So from, as an example, from ncoe@dsci.in, right? On 11 September, 2020. At 7:23 a.m., this email started. It went to a local host somewhere within their own domain. Then it was sent to an mcsv.net server. From there, it was IPHMX server, right? Then it traversed, okay? Then it came to outlook.com, and from outlook.com, it was some prod.outlook.com, and then traversed, and then actually it was delivered, all right? So this is how it tells you. It will give you a very, you know, beautiful way of showing you how emails traverse within, before you reaching the sender, what all application, what all servers are involved, all right, and what times, even their IP addresses. Okay, now let's look at cybercrime. All right, so now cybercrime, when you look at that, so cyber forensics again plays a very important role in the investigation, as most of the communication now is present on and relies on emails. So cybercrime or email crime investigation involves examination of origin and the content of that email as evidence, from evidence point of view, right? Now billions of emails traverse the globe every day, all right? Like any other form of communication, it is also misused, right? So some of the major email related crimes can be email spoofing, sending malicious code through email, email bombing or sending threatening email, all email frauds. So crimes committed by sending emails and then crimes supported by emails, right? So there are two differences. When I'm sending emails, I'm spamming people, right? From a crime perspective, and then you can do phishing, mail bombs, mail storms. Okay. And what are the crimes supported through emails? You can do identity fraud, cyber stalking, and child pornography or abduction. So spam emails, right? Spamming, right? Spamming is primarily unsolicited, unwanted junk emails being sent in bulk to say any recipient list, right? And they don't want it. They did not ask for it, right? So you send them unwanted emails, right? So it's spam is usually sent for commercial purposes, saying, you know, we got such and such item, please buy it, you know, and this is the discount and all these things. And it can be sent in massive volumes, right? Using automation, botnets, network, and all these are infected, I remember, right? Most of spam is very dangerous. Then phishing, right? Now cybercrime phishing is in which the cybercrime in which the target or targets are contacted by emails, telephone or text message. This is usually done by someone posing as a legitimate institution or somebody, you know, familiar, and they lure or trick the individuals, and they trick them into providing sensitive information or data, right? And it can be personal identifiable information, PII as it is called, or some banking card related details, password, IDs, date of birth, location, some numbers, okay? So that is primarily phishing, and it comes under social engineering attacks. Then you got mail bombs, okay? Now mail bombs is sending a huge massive amount of email to one specific person or one system, all right? Now huge amount of emails may simply fill up his hard disk, right? Or in case of server, it may be too much for the server to actually handle, right? So the memories, processes, all these things may go down, and the server in fact may stop functioning and crash, right? So it's like a denial of service attack, okay? So in the past, mail bombs have been used to punish internet users who've been, you know, violators, for example, right? For example, they would spam others, and then suddenly somebody would spam them. So they would do it by sending email storms. All right. Sorry, they would send by email bombs. Now, email bombs, as we talk about. So email storm can be a topic of humor or irritation, right? So when you bomb somebody, right, it can potentially cause a problem as servers may become overloaded and then crash, right? Mail bombs not only are, you know, the senders should be wary of themselves because you expose yourself, all right? So let's look at now look at crimes that are supported through emails, all right? So identity fraud is, you know, obviously a very critical one and the top list attack, right? And this is used by one person, right, of another person's, assuming another person's information without authorization, and to commit a crime or deceive somebody else, defraud other people, right, as a third party, okay? Then you got cyber stalking, right? So cyber stalking is repeated use of electronic communication to harass or maybe frighten somebody, for example, sending them threatening emails, all right? So it's a technological harassment directed towards specific individuals, right? And there are specific forms of cyber stalking that can take place. For example, placing orders for delivery in somebody else's name, right? So, right? And then he suddenly receives some information or some food or something and says, no, I didn't do it, right? Also, gathering information on victims is again cyber stalking, right? Spreading false rumors is stalking, right? Encouraging others to join in the harassment is again part of cyber stalking. Threatening to harm people through email, all right? Creating fears and paranoia, you know, on someone else, right? Or hacking into online accounts, all right? So all these things are very high level, you know, crimes that are supported by email. Then you got one of the most heinous ways of crime called child pornography and abduction, right? So production of child pornography, right, creates, now this will create a permanent record on the child's sexual abuse, right? So these images, if they are placed on the internet, you know, sent, the victimization of a child becomes, you know, a permanent mark on them. So, and they start to suffer lifetime victimization, right? By knowing that, you know, images of their sexual abuse are there forever, right? So that is again a very heinous crime that are, all right? Now, cyber investigation, we can talk about. So, email investigation involves metadata, port scanning, as well as keyword searching. Right now, some of the common techniques that can be used for cyber forensic investigations are header analysis, server investigation, network device investigation, right? Server mail fingerprints, and software embedded identifiers, all right? So as an investigator, as a cyber crime investigator investigating on emails, right? You have the following goals when you perform email forensics. So step one is you seize the computer and of course the email account. Then you acquire that email data as step two. All right. You look at the email messages, examine them. Step four, you retrieve the email headers. Okay. Step five, you analyze the email header. You can also recover deleted emails as step six. All right. So these are the six steps that any investigator does when performing email forensics, and we look at each step one by one. All right. So the first step for email investigation is seizing the computer and the email account. All right. So seize the victim's computer and the email account. So for this, you need to obtain a search warrant, right, which will include permissions to perform some on-site investigation on the suspect's system computer, the email server that is used to send the email which are under investigation for verification, checking, investigation. So, or maybe if there are more computers involved, right? Say for example, it's an office where multiple systems were involved. So then you seize all computers and all email accounts that are suspected to be involved in the crime. All right. So you seize the email account by changing the password, right? Because that has been used by the victims or maybe victims, all right, or the crime or the attackers, right? So you first of all you change their existing password, all right, by asking the suspect for the password or obtaining it from the email server or resetting it or using any tools. Now the second part is acquiring that email data. Okay, you've logged into the victims or the system. Okay, so before acquiring it, the investigator should always consider the following scenarios, right? The suspect accesses their emails, his or her, through any desktop-based client, right? Or they may be using some web-based email account, right? Through which the crime was done. All right? So there are two ways, a desktop-based application client or web-based, right? So email data acquisition methods again would be different for each scenarios, all right? So if it is a desktop based client, right, so that would be somewhere say a PST file lying somewhere, all right, or PST file using MS Outlook, right? So then you need to go to that particular file and then take it out. And to acquire email from email data from web accounts, right, so you need to have credentials of the suspect, right? So you can use Google Takeout to download and create an offline backup of any Google account in the mailbox file format. It's called mmbox file format. Or you can synchronize that specific webmail with Outlook to create copies, local copies of that email data, and then acquire them using forensic tools. Okay, so there are two ways for web accounts. The third step involves examination of these messages. Now you got the messages, okay, the data is already there. Now you need to examine them. So you look at the acquired email messages closely, and then you need to look at the following: the sender, subject, attachments, email body, right? So all information that you can think about, you'll have everything over here, all right? So sender, subject, attachment, and the body, right? So that is where you closely examine each and everything. Step four retrieves the email headers. Like for example, you identified an email, right, through which the crime was committed. So now you need to retrieve that email header. All right. So for a desktop Outlook client, right, so you open the message, click on file properties, copy the content from internet headers. There's a small window that pops up and you got internet headers, and save that content in a text editor, right? So you see that you open a file, you open that email, click on file properties, go to email headers. Now for retrieving email information, right? So you click on, and then you have all these information. It'll be a huge dump where you copy all the header contents, right? And then when you want to use Gmail, for example, people nowadays, a lot of people use Gmail by default. So you need to log in through his Gmail ID. You click on that received email, click on the right side where you see three dots, okay? And then you navigate to show original, and then save the contents in a text editor. For example, you see this email and you see three dots marked in yellow. Browse to show original, and you'll see all the original message, all right? So which actually shows you message ID, created, from, to, subject, SPF, DKIM, DM, DMARC, all these things, right? So these are the details that are required for investigations, right? It'll also show you all the header contents, all right? What the email was about, where, how was it sent, where was it sent, which all servers did it traverse, and all everything. All right, so you'll see a lot of stuff, right? So these are the stuff that is important. The fifth part actually involves analysis of this email header that you've got now, right? So there you'll see timestamp, which is date and time when the email was sent, from, which will show you the email ID of the sender, right? This may be forged in case of spams. Then two is the recipient's email ID, message ID, right? So every message ideally has a global unique identifier. So it's a part before the @, which is the timestamp of the email, and the part after the @ is the FQDN of the domain. So before the @ that you see, right, this part, right, so that is the timestamp, which is the message ID. Then you got subject, which is whatever subject is given by the sender, all right, and the MIME version, which is multipurpose internet mail extensions. Then received headers, which displays all the servers from which the email traversed before reaching the receiver, right? So for example, somebody sent an email from USA to India, all right, and in between there were 10 servers involved, right? From one server it was sent to another, then it traversed and then came over and reached your mailbox, okay? So whatever servers were traversed, which were, you know, all those details will be there. There'll also be a return path, all right, which is a return email when you reply to that. So that reply will be sent to that email. So you should note that for spam emails, the sender or the return path does not exist, because when you reply back, it will bounce. Okay. So when it is an authentic email, you would have a return path, or the return SPF, which is sender policy framework. So this enables sending emails on behalf of their domains, right? So for example, a domain can send on behalf of somebody else, all right? For example, you've got Gmail, right? Now Gmail offers you to host your email, your domain, your mail domain on their, using their domain. So for example, Zoho also does that, right? So you can have your own domain, but they'll be using Google servers or Gmail servers. Okay, so that is SPF. Now a failed SPF again indicates spam, because there's no policy framework there, right? The domains aren't there. Then DKIM is domain key identified email. It's a kind of a signature which verifies if emails were received from the actual origin of the whatever the sender says he is, all right? So it's like an ID. Okay, so these are the ways to analyze or the five steps, or the step five, where you analyze email header regarding all these things. Step six, you can also recover deleted emails. Now for Outlook, when emails are deleted, they are moved to deleted item folder, right? If still these emails are deleted from the deleted folder, all right, I empty my deleted folder. So these emails don't go anywhere. They go to an unallocated space off the drive. And these can still be recovered, right? If that unallocated is not replaced with any new data, you can still undelete and, you know, recover all your lost emails. All right, so that is how you recover emails. So when you think about email hunting and detection, right? So there's a small sheet that I'm sharing. So you can look at the attribute, the technique, and what exactly to look for. So for example, if you have the sender's IP address, right? So you calculate the email count by sender IP, sender domain. If possible, calculate the email count per sender IP,
right? When you do a search, when you look at investigations, you look at how many times he sent that email from that particular IP address. All right, if there are more than one IP for the same sender domain, all right, and the email count is very small for one of the IPs, it may indicate a domain spoofing or phishing. So then you can exclude known email service providers like gmail.com or Hotmail, Yahoo, and then focus only on corporate emails, right? So that is one way of doing investigations. Another is when you look at an attribute for sender domain. Okay, so you get a list of most used brands in phishing attacks, right? Then you look generated what like look at look like domains for these. For example, using DNS Twist or some other tools like Facebook.com. So you have FACEBOOK, right? You can also use FCAEBOOK. So they exactly look like those domains. So search emails that come from these lookalike domains, right? That is what you should be looking at. All right, and then apply this same technique for your own domains or other domains. You can also detect sender domains that are seen under for the first time in the environment. Check their domain age, right? Newly registered domains may be malicious, maybe spam domains, right? Maybe attacker domains. For example, during COVID, when COVID started in around April, May, June, that time frame, there was a rise of almost 600% in registering new domains, right? All for emails, all sending spam emails. Another attribute you can look at is sender address, right? So you calculate the email address count, and then you look at the bidirectional traffic, how much was sent, how much was received. So high number of inbound and outbound traffic might indicate C2 over email, right? Or a high number of outbound email between the same sender and receiver might indicate some data is being exfiltrated. Exfiltration is where an attacker is already sitting on your machine and taking out all your data. Okay, so high inbound outbound emails can indicate this. And so for ensuring you have email hunting and detection, so there's a sheet that I've fixed here, right? You can look at the attribute from address, right? So that technique is to calculate the D count from the address. Where what do you look for? You look at two different IPs from the same address, right? Which may indicate phishing, right? Whitelisting secondary IPs if the domain is not known can also be done. Now, if the attribute you look at is recipient address, the receiver's address. So calculate the email count per sender address, right? Or recipient address, or recipient address, sender address, right? Depending on this. Now, high number of inbound and outbound emails, all right, might indicate a C2 over email, and a number of outbound emails between the same sender receiver might indicate some data exfiltration is going on. So that would indicate, in plain language, your email has been hacked, all right, and somebody is trying to pull out all your data. They're trying to exfiltrate it, all right, and remove all your data, all right. So when you look at recipient domain, all right, so you calculate the sum of email, the size per recipient, or the domain for the outbound domain emails, right? Higher values may again indicate somebody has hacked and they are moving out all your data, all your critical sensitive information, right? Then URL information, so you calculate URL or the URL domain count for the last 24 hours, correlate that with other logs, right? Whatever data was sent, whatever information was sent, proxy information, proxy server. So small values may indicate spear phishing, for example, which is a directed phishing against a particular person, right? It's a targeted phishing attack, right? So a CEO, a head of engineering, or head of some department might be hit with that, right? So high values may be phishing or marketing spams, all right? So we looked at email basics. As the first step, we looked at the roles of emails and investigations. We also look at email forensic tools, 405 tools, right? We looked at some email crimes, the way they can be conducted. Then we looked at the steps, how to investigate email crimes or email investigations. And then we looked at a sheet which tells you how to perform email hunting and detection. All right. So thank you so much.